stand and we'll start with our opening song.
Father in heaven, we're truly thankful for this day you've blessed us with. Lord, just as that song says, we do need to lean on Jesus each and every day of our lives. And just praise and worship to you, Father. And Lord, I just pray for all of those who are not feeling well and sick and not able to be here this morning. May you guide them and give them strength and watch over each and every one of us as we go through our life here on this earth. May our time be spent in worship and seekfulness of you and at all times in our lives. Lord, we're just grateful for this time and ask that you bless it. And to Jesus' name I pray. Amen.
Oh,
screen.
Okay.
Actually, first, we're gonna do our memory verse, because it's helpful to say it out loud to help us remember. This comes out of Ruth, chapter 1, verses 16 and 17. Don't ask me to leave you and turn back. Wherever you go, I will go. Wherever you live, I will live. Your people will be my people, and your God will be my God. Wherever you die, I will die, and there I will be buried. May the Lord punish me severely if I allow anything but death to separate us. This morning's scripture reading is going to be taken out of Judges chapter 6, if you would like to follow along. I'll be reading verses 1 through 10. While you're turning there, by the way, I apologize for not having wished Happy Mother's Day to all the mothers here this morning. We truly are grateful for our mothers, and what a special day to remember them. Judges 6, beginning with verse 1. Then the children of Israel did evil in the sight of the Lord. So the Lord delivered them into the hand of Midian for 7 years. And the hand of Midian prevailed against Israel. Because of the Midianites, the children of Israel made for themselves the dens, the caves, and the strongholds which are in the mountains. So it was, whenever Israel had sown, Midianites would come up. Also Amalekites and the people of the east would come up against them. Then they would encamp against them and destroy the produce of the earth as far as Gaza, and leave no sustenance for Israel, neither sheep, nor ox, nor donkey. For they would come up with their livestock and their tents, coming in as numerous as locusts. Both they and their camels were without number, and they would enter the land to destroy it. So Israel was greatly impoverished because of the Midianites, and the children of Israel cried out to the Lord. And it came to pass, when the children of Israel cried out to the Lord because of the Midianites, that the Lord sent a prophet to the children of Israel, who said to them, "Thus says the Lord God of Israel, I brought you up from Egypt, and brought you out of the house of bondage, and I delivered you out of the hand of the Egyptians, and out of the hand of all who oppressed you, and drove them out before you, and gave you their land. Also I said to you, I am the Lord your God. Do not fear the gods of the Amorites, in whose land you dwell. But you have not obeyed my voice." May the Lord add a blessing to the reading of this word.
Thank you.
prepare for our communion time. If you did not get your communion when you came in, they're on the back table back there, the communion cups with the juice and the bread. So if you would like to grab one, and then I will read the communion meditation and we'll have a prayer. About three and a half weeks ago, if you've been following along with the daily Bible readings, we read out of Deuteronomy. That was Deuteronomy 12, 23 through 25. And that passage is what today's communion meditation is going to be based on. And I'll read it again for you. It says in Deuteronomy 12, 23, "Only be sure that thou eat not the blood, for the blood is the life. And thou mayest not eat the life with the flesh. Thou shalt not eat it, thou shalt not pour it upon the earth as water. Thou shalt not eat it, that it may go well with thee and with thy children after thee, when thou shalt do that which is right in the sight of the Lord." There's a song that we sing, "Victory in Jesus goes, O victory in Jesus, my Savior, forever. He sought me and he bought me with what? His redeeming blood. He loved me ere I knew him, and all my love is due him. He plunged me to victory beneath the cleansing blood." That time-honored chorus speaks volumes. Notice it does not say victory for Jesus, but victory in Jesus. It was not Jesus who needed victory. It was not Jesus who had a sin problem. It was not Jesus who was powerless against death. It was not Jesus who was helplessly separated from God. But God loved the world so much, he gave his only begotten Son to accomplish what we could not: conquer sin and death, restoring man's relationship with God. We can be victorious in Jesus because the victory was for us. A profound expression of a God's undying love for his children. Once again, the blood is life. When we come together for Holy Communion, we reflect on Christ's life and what it means to us as individuals and what it means to us as a body. Today, we celebrate his glorious resurrection, evidence that he was all that he said he was, that he is able to save, that he is the way, the truth, and the life, that he is love, that he is the word, that he is the light, he is the good shepherd, our king, our priest, our God, and our salvation. The blood is life. As we prepare to take our communion today, let us recognize that victory was not free. It came at a price. Jesus willingly suffered unspeakable humiliation and pain on the cross. It cost a body broken and innocent blood to be poured out for the redemption of sins. We remember his broken body. I want to emphasize that remember. We talked about that a little bit in Sunday school. Why do we do this on a weekly basis? How many of you remember what you had for lunch last Sunday? Probably not very many. That's why we do things on a regular basis, to remember. It says right here in front of us on this table, "Do this in remembrance of me," a constant reminder to remember Jesus. We remember his broken body with the bread. We remember his blood poured out for us with the cup. By doing this, we proclaim his death and claim victory in Jesus. As Deuteronomy 23 states, thousands of years before Jesus, the blood is our victory and life. Let us pray. Father in heaven, we thank you so much for your son Jesus. We thank you for that time and that horrible crucifixion that he endured for each and every one of us. We're thankful that he loved us so much to do what he did. He cared so much because he knew that we couldn't do it. Thank you, Jesus, for that sacrifice that you paid for each and every one of us. As we come before you this morning and take this bread, which does represent your broken body, and the cup, which represents your shed blood, the blood that is the life, our victory, let us remember you, Jesus. Let us remember what you did. Lord, we just thank you for this time and ask that you bless us. It's in Jesus' name I ask it. Amen. What is important too, and normally, you know, we used to have this time as a time of offering, and same thing, we have the offering plates in the back, and you can just put them in on your way out, or if you've already taken care of that on your way in, great. But I just wanted to offer up a prayer, because I know through all of this, I am truly thankful and grateful for a loving God, and you know, maybe not all of us, but many of us have maybe lost our jobs for the time being, had to stay at home or whatever the case may be, but God still takes care of us, doesn't he? And I want to offer up a prayer to God just in thanksgiving for all that he does bless us with. Father in heaven, we just, we do thank you, Lord. Lord, you're such a loving and kind God, as we've been talking about last week and this week too. And Father, we thank you for that hesedness in you. And Lord, I just ask that you continue to bless us. We're thankful that you have through this time. And Father, it's just a blessing to know that that you provide everything that we need. We may not always get what we want, but we have all that we need. And we can thank you for that. Lord, I just pray as we go forth that we can continue to seek you in our lives. And we know that our time here spent on earth was well worthwhile when it's spent in time for you. Lord, just thank you for this time and thank you for this day. I pray these things in Christ's name. Amen.
Thank you. as I walked through the door, I sensed His presence, and I knew this was a place where love abounds.
Thank you, Jerry.
Well, I'd like to wish all the mothers a happy Mother's Day. And I want to start off with an apology. I totally messed up. I've been working about 4 weeks, have a series taught by Victoria Jacoby on the Book of Ruth. And I thought I had everything taken place. The CDs did not arrive. I have a download link. So contact me, and hopefully the Mother's Day gifts will get here tomorrow or the next day. But I want to wish all the mothers happy Mother's Day. And we started last week by talking about an Old Testament word, a Hebrew word called hesed, meaning God's faithfulness, God's loving kindness. It is a word that is extremely hard to give one English word for. So we talked about that. What's interesting to me about hesed is it really, to me, describes a mother's love, a good mother's love for her children, okay? And so I want to talk to you about the first mother we encounter in the Book of Ruth. And hesed allows us to understand Ruth, okay? And that mother is Naomi. We're going to be in Ruth chapter 1. Anybody have any idea what two books in the Bible are named after women? Anybody? Oh, it looks like Victoria knows. Esther and Ruth, exactly right. What's interesting about Ruth is it is told from Ruth's perspective, from a woman's perspective. Let's go to Ruth verse 1. Ruth chapter 1 verse 1. I'm reading out of the English Standard Version. If it sounds a little different to you, but that's the version I'm reading out of. And the first phrase simply says, in the days when the judges ruled, there was a famine in the land. 3 months ago, if I told you we'd run out of toilet paper, what would you have thought of my prediction? 3 months ago, if I told you that there was no market for the cows, what would you have thought? And I say that because we have a modern, they call it a food chain. You know, modern markets, they've got everything mapped out how it goes. We have all these sophisticated means. So famine is hard for us to understand until the last 3 months, isn't it? Well, in the ancient world, it was a much more tenuous affair with food. There's a lot of times that famine took place. Now, in that one little phrase we just read, Ruth gives us two clues as to when the Book of Ruth took place. It was during the Day of Judges, and it happened during a famine. Dale read earlier Judges 6, 1 through 10, and I believe that is the setting. Now, I want you to think about what that means. It means the first tragic event in Ruth's life was a famine caused by war. And we're next going to read another hardship. Let's look at that. And it says this, and a man of Bethlehem in Judah went to sojourn in the country of Moab and his wife and with his wife and his two sons. A key to understand the Book of Ruth is that Bethlehem means house of bread. So literally the husband leaves a house of bread looking for bread. He leaves the protection of God's promised hesedness and trust in the earthly wealth of Moab. Now, this journey that they're talking about here is about 50 miles and would take about a week. There's a map in your notes for you. Let's look at verse 2 and 3. And it says this, the man was Elimelech, and the wife of his wife was Naomi, and the name of his two sons were Malchon and Chilion. They were Ephraites, tribe of Ephraim, from Bethlehem and Judah. They went into the country of Moab and remained there. Verse 3, but Elimelech, the husband of Naomi, died when she was left with her two sons. Can you imagine the grief of Naomi when Elimelech dies? She's already encountered war and famine and had to leave her house that she grew up in. Single parenthood today is difficult, especially if your kids are quarantined in the same house with you and you have to teach, right? But can you imagine the ancient Middle East where there wasn't a thing like civil rights? Then it goes on to say that he took Moabite wives. The name of one was Orpah, and the name of the other was Ruth. They lived there about 10 years. Moms, what is it like for you when your child rejects your faith? We, as Gentiles in America, don't quite get this phrase. But when those boys marry outside the faith of Israel, they were rejecting Naomi's faith as well. And when we put much effort to pass on our faith to our children and they reject it, you know what? It hurts. Parents, do you ever wrestle with feelings of failure, like you haven't done enough? Why did they make those poor choices? I think Naomi felt all of these things. But there's something else that that little phrase also means. For Naomi, it means that she can't go back to the place where she grew up. She can't go home. Now her boys are married to Moabite women, and she's going to be there for the remainder of the time. I think it's a good reminder, moms and dads, that faith is not a guaranteed family legacy. And what I mean by that is your child is not automatically saved just because you are saved. It is our job as parents to set up a foundation our kids can build on. The rest is up to them. And sometimes your kids will build without faltering or wavering. But sometimes you will have a child who walks away from the foundation you've so carefully created as they try to build a house on sand. And it's so hard to see it happen. I believe all we can do is like Naomi. What did Naomi do? She prayed, she modeled, and she clung to God. Let's look at verse 5. Both Mahlon and Chilion died. So the woman was left without her two sons and her husband. How would you sum up verse 5? I think you could sum it up in one word. Alone. No husband, alone. No sons, alone. In a foreign country, alone. In stories like this, we often are quick to ask, what did Naomi do wrong? You know what? I can't see that she did anything wrong. Which leads me to ask another question. Why are we so quick to assign blame when tragedy happens and when things do not go as planned? Let me ask, we talked about it all week on social media. What did Ahmad do wrong? If you contracted the coronavirus, what did you do wrong? If you lost a loved one, what did you do wrong? Nothing, right? We need to grasp that. It reminds me of John chapter 9, where Jesus heals a blind man. In John 9, 2 and 3, we have a conversation with him and his disciples. And it says this, and his disciples asked him, Rabbi, who sinned, this man or his parents, that he was born blind? Jesus answered, it was not this man that sinned or his parents, but listen to the last phrase, but that the works of God might be displayed in him. I think just like the blind man, It was not because of sin that Naomi experienced ruin in her life. I believe she experienced hardship so the works of God might be displayed. Let's ask ourselves a deeper question this morning. What bitter pill is in your life right now you're trying to swallow? Could that bitter pill be in your life to display the works of God? I'm not saying every one of them is. I think sometimes we need to stop and think about it, pray about it. I think we need to ask, how can my circumstance display the work of God? Well, let's move on. I think it'd be more constructive for us to ask of Naomi, what did Naomi do right? I'm going to read 6 through 14. It says, then she arose with her daughters-in-law to return from the country of Moab, for she had heard in the fields of Moab that the Lord had visited his people and given them food. So she set out from the place where she was with her two daughters-in-law. They went on the way to return to the land of Judah. Verse 8, but Naomi said to her two daughters-in-law, and they went on the way to return to the land of Judah. But Naomi said to her two daughters-in-law, go return each of you to her mother's house. May the Lord deal kindly with you as you have dealt with the dead and with me. The Lord grant that you might find rest, each of you, in the house of her husband. Then she kissed them, and they lifted up their voices and wept. And they said to her, no, we will return with you to your people. But Naomi said, turn back, my daughters, why will you go with me? Have I yet sons in my womb that may become your husbands? Turn back, my daughters, go your way, for I am too old, what, to have a husband? If I should say I even have hope, even if I should have a husband this night and should bear sons, would you therefore wait till they're grown? Would you therefore refrain from marrying? No, my daughters, for it is exceedingly bitter to me for your sake that the hand of the Lord has gone out against me. Then they lifted up their voices and wept again. And Orpah kissed her mother-in-law, but Ruth clung to her, and she said, see, your sister-in-law has gone back to her people and her gods. Return after your sister-in-law. If we could, see if we could get the screen to come up. If we could switch inputs. And what we pick up that Naomi did right is understand the first six verses and these verses that Naomi, for the first time in her life, is free of all obligations. She is free to do what she wants. And what does she do? She goes home. She goes back to the house of Israel. She goes back to the house of bread and to its God. Have you ever noticed some mornings, some seasons in life, what we need to do is just pick ourselves up, dust ourselves off, and return home to God? Isn't that what the key is to keep on going? And that's what I see in her life. Let's recite May's memory verse we read earlier, or recited earlier. These are the next two verses, and it says simply this, don't ask me to leave you and turn back. Wherever you go, I will go. Wherever you live, I will live. Your people will be my people, and your God will be my God. Wherever you die, I will die, and there I will be buried. May the Lord punish me severely if I allow anything but death to separate us. Now, Ruth's famous words are a reminder, in my mind, that life without God and life without family is empty. Life without God and family is senseless. And if you think about it, Naomi's life is an example of this, isn't it? Think of all of her life's work, how she built a home, how she established a career, how she raised a family. And yet there is nothing left except for God. And if she hadn't had God, she would have had nothing. God must be our foundation. Now, verses 19 through 22 remind me that what Naomi did right was go, 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 and never give up. How about the mothers in your life? Have you ever seen that in them? I've seen it in the mothers of my life. That's a key, is to keep on keeping on. Look, verse 19, it says, so the two of them went on until they came to Bethlehem. And when they came to Bethlehem, the whole town was stirred because of them. And the women said, is this Naomi? So she said to them, do not call me Naomi, call me Mara, for Almighty has dealt very bitterly with me. Verse 21, I went away full, and the Lord has brought me back empty. Why call me Naomi when the Lord has testified against me and the Almighty has brought calamity upon me? So Naomi returned, and the Ruth the Moabite, her daughter-in-law with her, who returned from the country of Moab, and they came to Bethlehem at the beginning of the barley harvest. I don't know why, but I think sometimes we think that it's a spiritual gift to have the gift of denial. We look at these last two verses and we think, well, why is Naomi so upset? How can she say that God has done this to me? Well, he's the creator and he's the all-powerful one, isn't he? And the circumstances are bitter. God doesn't ask us to deny reality. But it also causes me to ask, what do we do when the going gets rough? Do we get going, or do we just sit down and whine? It kind of reminds me of the difference between moms now and moms then. Maybe you've seen this on Facebook. Moms now say, well, that word is inappropriate. Moms used to say, what? Say that again, I'll wash your mouth out with soap, right? Moms now say, good job trying one bite of the dinner I made. Moms used to say, eat it or go hungry, right? Number three, I can see you're upset. Take a deep breath and use your words is what is said today, right? I remember my mama saying, better stop crying. I'll give you something to cry about. And everybody's shaking their heads. And number four, today we say you can't walk, I'll drive you, right? It used to be mamas would say what? Want to go somewhere? Take your bike. Be back by dark. Things have changed a lot. But all that reminds me that moms, one of the things moms have built in them that inspire all of us is their tenacity. They don't never give up. And I want you to think about after wandering from God and his promised inheritance in the land of Moab, Naomi returns to Israel and she blesses her daughters-in-law so the Lord may give them chesed. If you go down and look at verse 8, she prays that God would deal kindly with them. Man, she is a profound woman. And one of the ways that God deals kindly with them is redemption. Now, the idea of redemption in the Old Testament takes its start from the thought of property. It came from the idea that money is paid according to the law to buy back something which must be delivered or rescued. And from this, we get the word delivered or rescued. And from the very start, that word redemption throughout the Old Testament is used in a sense of deliverance, of being taken care of us. Let me share with you Isaiah 44, verse 24. Thus says the Lord, your Redeemer, who formed you from the womb. I am the Lord, what? Who made all things, who alone stretched out the heavens, who spread out the earth by myself. He is our Redeemer. He is the one we depend on. One of the ways that God rescued or redeemed Naomi was using Naomi's character, who she was. Now, as I say that, I believe Naomi got a bum rap and a lot of lessons. Preparing for this sermon, I was going through and reviewing all the other lessons, and I saw this one very interesting children's lesson on Ruth that had an ugly old hag in front of a mirror. And the phrase was, mirror, mirror on the wall, who's the bitterest of them all? And then the name above the old hag was Ruth. Ruth gets that bum rap of being bitter from verse 20. Do not call me Naomi, call me Mara, for the Almighty has dealt very bitterly with me. I contend instead that Ruth had the character of the fruit of the Holy Spirit that we find in Galatians 5. What is that? Love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, self-control. It's a reminder, isn't it, that parents, all we do and all we hope for our kids and our grandkids, all comes down to what? Our character. That's what we can offer them, isn't it? To model. And we're dependent in turn on the Holy Spirit to display God's hesed in our life. Now, it's interesting, Naomi's name means pleasant, and yet most people think she's bitter. I would contend we could even go further than pleasant and say joyful. Now, how do I know this? Well, I think if you sit down, remember, I challenge you to sit down in one setting and read the whole book of Ruth. I think if you read the whole book and not just verse 20, I think you'll get that idea. But specifically, let me ask you, what daughter-in-law would follow her mother-in-law 50 miles through the desert on a horse with no name? No, that's another song. Never mind. And we know that a daughter and a mother-in-law's relationship can be difficult, correct? And is a daughter-in-law going to weep like Orpah and Ruth did? Orpah made her decision, but Ruth follows her. Is Ruth going to follow 50 miles through the desert and give up her home and everything for a woman that is full of bitterness, vindictiveness, and unforgiveness? I don't think so. I also want to point out, if you have your Bible open to Ruth, look in verse 20 of chapter 2, Ruth 2:20. I find this very interesting in Ruth 2:20. Where he says, and Naomi said to her daughter-in-law, may he, Boaz, be blessed by the Lord, whose kindness has not forsaken the living or the dead. Naomi instantly recognizes the kindness of Boaz. What type of person recognizes kindness? I would say to you, it's a kind of person. Third, I want you to get a glimpse in chapter 2 of Naomi's goodness, her hesedness. Look at chapter 2, verse 11. Boaz shares with Ruth how he has heard all she has done for Naomi. Now, there's a couple barriers to overcome here. First, he's a male. They are female. He is a wealthy landowner. They are in poverty. So my question is, how did he hear about all that Ruth had done for Naomi? who was telling the story on Ruth? I think there's only one person that was sharing how good Ruth was, and that was Naomi. Does a bitter person sit and share how good her daughter-in-law, are you more likely to hear, my daughter-in-law just can't do anything right? Which is more likely? We see God's chesed with this. God's chesed is also rescued with community. I want you to think about the story again. I want you to think, when you think about the story we just read in chapter 1, the words of John Donne. You know, how many remember or had to read this in school? It says, no man is an island entire of itself. Every man is a piece of the continent, a part of the main. If a cloud be washed away by the sea, Europe is less as well as if a promontory were as well. If a manner of thy friend of thine own were, any man's death diminishes me because I am involved in mankind, and therefore never sin to know for whom what the bell tolls. It tolls for thee. Man, isn't that true? I want you to think about how God's chesed, his loving kindness, rescued Naomi through community. She's in a foreign country, has no sons, no husband. She's facing starvation. And how does God provide for her, her two daughter-in-laws? And then she returns back to Bethlehem, the house of bread, to seek bread. Some of you have heard the story time and time again. I grew up in a small town called Loup City. How many of you have ever gone back to your hometown? And everything changes, but everything remains the same. And I think when Naomi came back, it was the same story. Everything had changed. There's a lot of changes, but she knew what? All of the families. She knew all the relationships. She knew who was important. And she also knew about the tradition of gleaning. We wouldn't understand that, but gleaning was an ancient form of food stamps that would leave food on the ground so the poor could pick it up. And it was this community that God would use to rescue Naomi. And lastly, I think we need to recognize God's chesed also redeemed Naomi with Christ. We've already seen in a patriarchal society, women are protected and provided for by men. The book of Ruth is a story that man's best intentions will be flawed and will fall short. It's a reminder, isn't it, that man needs a redeemer. Man needs a Messiah. Man needs a Savior. I almost bet that you've never seen this verse used for a Mother's Day sermon. But let me read it to you. Yet she will be saved through childbearing if they continue in faith and love and holiness with self-control. I believe the childbearing mentioned here, boy, what Paul is getting at refers to the birth of Jesus Christ. Both men and women are saved through childbearing because how did Jesus come? He came through childbearing. And it really shows us the hope of the world is the birth of a baby in Bethlehem by the name of Jesus. And the hope of the whole world is a child. And what we see is God is going to use the persistence of Ruth to bring hope to the whole world. And he's going to remain faithful and make sure that she finishes the race. Now, I want to close with this. Moms, let me ask, has being a mom gone as planned? No. Being a parent, gone like it was planned? No. How long have you been praying for something to turn around in your child's or your grandchild's life? How long have you been praying for that? It's easy to get discouraged, isn't it? I think of Ruth, and I think of Hebrews 11, 13, and 16. These all died in faith, not having received the things promised. Think about your mom, your grandma. How many of them died not receiving all they longed for? It is a condition of the faithful. But then it says, but having seen them and greeted them from afar and having acknowledged that they were strangers and exiles on earth. They could see what it was to be here on earth, how God made it, but it wasn't going to happen. Life here on earth were exiles and strangers. Verse 14, for people who speak thus make it clear they are seeking a homeland. Verse 15, they had been thinking of that land from which they had gone out. They would have had opportunity to return. But as it is, they desire a better country that is a heavenly one. Therefore, God is not ashamed to be called their God, for he has prepared them a city. You know, in closing, what's interesting with Ruth, it would be hundreds of years later that her descendant would be born in Bethlehem and given the name Jesus for the forgiveness of sins. And it would be God's power and his steadfast love that worked through sinful people through those hundreds of years to bring about the redemption. She died without seeing it fully. But the book of Ruth says at the end that she held the baby Ruth gave her. She got a glimpse of what was to come. And we have a glimpse of what is to come. And it all begins with a journey to the house of bread, Bethlehem. That 50-mile journey begins with one step. And that's coming forward and asking Christ to be your Lord and Savior. Come forward if that is your decision. Love to pray for you if you need prayers this morning. as we explore the book of Ruth. And remember, I'm challenging you, just take 15 minutes, sit down and read the four chapters. And what you will find in there is the character of God is one that is faithful from beginning to end to Ruth, Naomi, Boaz, and the nation of Israel, and to us. And when we sang, "Change my heart, O God, that I may be like you," we see that love, we are required what? To be faithful as well, to be hesed, to be steadfast in our love for one another and for God. Let's pray. Almighty God, I'm so joyful that my salvation, my redemption does not depend on my competence, but on your character. And what we see in the book of Ruth is your character is hesed, is faithful, as steadfast, as eternal. Lord, we praise you. Help us to serve and walk with you faithfully. These things we ask in Christ's name. Amen.